What's up, folks? This is Maximilian bringing you part 3 of the Ultimate Marvel vs. Capcom 3 Gameplay Breakdown. Welcome back, everyone, to Day 3 of Ultimate Marvel vs. Capcom 3 footage from EVO 2011. And once again, I'm sticking with my primary teams because I don't want to get kicked off these machines in order to get some more playtime, but we're going up against a Ghost Rider right now. Like I was saying, the majority of these games through this set is going to be with Strider, Wesker, and Dr. Doom, because this was one of my longer win streaks during the portion of the show. And the bummer thing about it is that during the entire show, it was hard to find a moment where Marvel vs. Capcom 3 or Street Fighter X Tekken didn't have like 10 to 20 people waiting to play, and that's approximately 30 to 40 minutes of standing up in line and waiting for someone's turn to go up. So if you don't see a lot of character variety on my end, I apologize. I only hope that there will be some character matches on my opposition side, so you can get some good views on the opposing or the other cast of characters besides just Strider. But we're looking at Ghost Rider right now, and I had a brief moment to play Ghost Rider, and I had a lot of fun with him. Actually, he's exactly how I thought he would be. If you watched the breakdown video earlier, I was going over some information on some initial impressions just by looking at Ghost Rider's moves of how I thought he would be like Omega Red. And to be honest, he really feels like Omega Red. I kind of like that too, because Omega Red was a character I liked to have fun with in Marvel 2 and Children of the Atom. He was one of those guys I was always really fond of, and Omega Red kind of being translated over to this game is pretty neat. And Ghost Rider kind of grew on me a little bit for the little bit of time I had playing. One of the crazier things, and I didn't get to test it too much, is Ghost Rider's jumping S is rather nuts. It's a downward, like, 45-degree angle attack that covers the majority, if not almost full screen. It's really effective, it's really good, it's used for spacing, and I think there was some moments where Justin Wong was playing at San Diego Comic-Con, and he was sticking to that move with assists, and dudes were having a hard time getting in because it's really good. I didn't know barely any other of his special moves at the time, so I wasn't able to do too much. But for the little bit of time I had, I was just playing like a zoning game and not really utilizing his projectiles and anything else for the most part. But it was working. The other really crazy thing, like I was saying, that Ghost Rider has, it's a little bit of what I call Sentinel Deja Vu for Marvel vs. Capcom 2. And if you guys didn't play a lot of Marvel 2 back in the day, one of the things that made Sentinel so broken in that game, amongst a bunch of other stuff, was the fact that all of his normal moves, if you blocked those normals, you took chip damage. And Sentinel was an attacking beast back in the day when you got good with them, and it's pretty crazy to see that. And it's even crazier to see that in Ultimate Marvel vs. Capcom 3, it appeared that Ghost Rider's normals did chip damage whenever he was like whipping around with the chain, and the chain would hit a guy from full distance, which are not special moves, they're like single button inputs. They were doing chip damage. So, really interesting mechanic. I'm actually kind of surprised that that even exists in this game. I thought that was a broken thing completely in Marvel 2, but Ghost Rider is a very interesting character. I'm not too sure exactly what his direct weaknesses are. His health doesn't seem extremely high by any means, more of like an average health, maybe 900k or so character. But he was fun. He has some pretty effective supers. All of his combos were extremely damaging. They're not conventional. I think if you go for the basic ABC launch and then do medium or BBC special in the air, it doesn't work with him. You actually have to mix it up a little bit, and then relaunching with him is kind of difficult as well. But nonetheless, kind of like Ghost Rider. I want to get more time with him, and unfortunately I didn't have that much opportunity to do so at EVO because I'm not a guy with a press badge. I'm just a player that hopefully would get some time with the game. And luckily I did, and I got really lucky and got on a few win streaks to actually break open some of the previous casts. As you can see right now, I'm using Deadpool. And one of the coolest damn outfits they could have possibly given him, I love this color scheme, it's actually awesome. A couple things I wanted to cover with Deadpool as well that are a bit disappointing and kind of exciting, and things I noticed while using the character in comparison to what I've been using the character nowadays, is that Deadpool's guns seem a little bit faster, like not by too much, nothing that you'd be like, wow, this is game breaking. It's they just got maybe a couple of frames or a single frame faster than what he had before, which is pretty good, which is which doesn't help out too much in his overall effectiveness, but he seems fairly similar to his original design in Marvel vs. Capcom 3. But he's missing something that bugs the hell out of me that I really wish that they didn't get rid of. And I tried doing it, I think, 3 or 4 times when I was using Deadpool actively, and he doesn't have the bolo loop in the corner anymore, which bugs the hell out of me. I really like the bolo loop. It's hilarious. The fact that he screams, "Get along, little doggy," like 5 to 7 times, I think, is pretty funny. And it's a really fun combo for me to pull off, and it seems to be gone. It seems that the hit stun off of his standing special doesn't allow him to follow up with the bolo loop initially after. It just, they pop out way too fast, so kind of a bummer. Other than that, Deadpool seems about the same, and Deadpool was never really that terrible a character. It's just, and it's with this game, it was in Marvel vs. Capcom 3 initially, it was like, well, why would I use Iron Man? Why would I use Doctor Doom? Why would I use Storm if I could use Magneto? You know, that situation was very, was a little annoying in the first game when you had one character that did the same thing as another character, but way more effective or way less effective. I can't say for sure that there's one thing that Doctor Doom does like better, or Iron Man does better than Magneto in regular Marvel 3. It's kind of shocking, but in this one we'll see. I actually want there to be like diversities amongst the cast, and I think that's what their goal is. That balance is going to be gone, where you don't have to default to Magneto if you want to win. And if you want to play Iron Man, you know, you just have to love Iron Man. I think the fact that they're trying to make him or give these characters attributes to make them more unique or to diversify them from other characters that do similar things is really good, because that was an issue in Marvel 2, and Marvel 2 never got balancing or changes. It just got console ports. So it seems that this game's goal is to give those individual characters that had traits similar to other characters more of a reason to play. And I really like that. I think that's a real good thing for the future of Ultimate Marvel and the future of Versus games, because if I can remember correctly, I think there was a recent interview with Nitsuma saying that there was initially going to be 58 characters in Ultimate Marvel vs. Capcom 3, but due to time constraints and them wanting to get the game out before holiday this year, they had to cut characters and they had to bring it down to 50. 50 total, including DLC. But I'm fine with that. I mean, it's the situation where we got Marvel vs. Capcom 3 only a year after it was announced, and that's insane. I think I was discussing this before. I'm extremely happy that they gave us, like, Marvel 3 in its current state, even though it has some stuff that bugs us and it was a little bare bones. The difference is that we had a game instead of not having a game. We clearly could have waited until, like, November of this year to actually play Marvel vs. Capcom 3 in full, which is what I was anticipating. I thought that's what was going to happen, but it didn't. They actually produced a pretty competent fighting game that was a lot of fun and a crazy sandbox, and it's rather unique. It's not, MVC3 isn't like many other fighting games out there as far as the openness with the assists and the characters. Anyway, I'm just going on. It's to the point now where they're going to have Ultimate Marvel 3 come out in November, and most likely are not the remaining characters that they had planned are hopefully going to show up as DLC. I'd like that. But in honesty, I'd also like another full version release. Like, if they took the Street Fighter 4 route and produced this disc version of the game, and then produced another DLC slash disc version, that'd be cool. If there was another Ultimate Marvel vs. Capcom 3, you know, part 2. But other than that, one thing I wanted to quickly touch on before we end this video is something that's coming back to the Versus games that I don't know if I loved it or not, but it was something that seemed like it was severely lacking when Marvel vs. Capcom 3 came out, and that's mashing. And not by regular button mashing, I mean when you do a hyper or you do a super or you do a certain move, you would wail on the buttons to increase the damage. That's something that's been around for quite a while in Versus games before, and the fact that that was gone in Marvel 3 kind of bugged me. And they're bringing it back, but it comes with a price, because if you mash moves now, what happens if you press all the face buttons in Marvel vs. Capcom 3? You get friggin' X-Factor. So there's gonna have to be coordinated mashing to go on now to, if you're planning on mashing out, you know, your special or whatever move allows you to boost damage when you mash that move out. So kind of crazy. If dudes mash too hard, you're gonna blow X-Factor. And it's an interesting mechanic, but that's gonna just about wrap it up for this video. I hope you guys enjoyed the latest part of the Ultimate Marvel vs. Capcom 3 breakdown. I'll be back with a few more matches and a few more games as soon as I possibly can. Thanks for watching, guys. I'll see you next time.